our first session, I emphasized the need for trust in any relationship which aspires to the condition of intimacy. And trust, as most of you know, may be very, very difficult to establish and usually is done step by step along a path of mutual risk, but it's very easily demolished. And we also mentioned, among other things, that when I enter a relationship out of great neediness, I may trust too readily or hastily, trust inappropriately, and that can mean that I open myself up to manipulation or to exploitation and to greater hurt, to being used and abused by one or the other of the manipulators and exploiters that are so predominant in our society. But I had pointed out, I think, in that talk that we all need intimacy. Okay, we need the affirmation of another. We're going to narrow our remarks to the matter of that relationship which has already been established and has some degree of trust, where we are both of reasonable goodwill, and which relationship we desire to place on a more intimate, warm, close basis. We're going to deal with particular communication skills which most of us didn't hear about when we were in school. Even today, while many youngsters are given rather greatly detailed courses in sexual anatomy and physiology and the art of sexual intercourse, if you will, very few are being given courses in interpersonal relationships and love and the skills required to build an intimate and loving relationship, which probably accounts for the million unwed mothers we have this year. First, let me give some general ideas about our communication, any human communication between us, including this one going on right now. Right now, in my attempt to communicate with you, what's happened is I've taken some personal experiences, some ideas, some thoughts, some feelings, my responses to life, in other words, my studies, researches, therapeutic work, and I've turned those experiences into ideas, thoughts, and feelings. And I take those ideas, thoughts, and feelings, and I seek out some words, because we're going to communicate verbally, I seek out some words with which to convey them to you. Now, that's verbal communication. However, even in this context, there are a lot of other communications going on at the same time, a sort of meta-communication, if you will, a communication beyond or surrounding the one that we think is going on, of my talking and your listening. My tone of voice is also saying something about what I am saying. It's making a comment on what I'm saying, because our tone of voice changes what we're saying. If I say, the dog is on the couch, for example, everything depends upon my tone of voice. If I say that in an irritable tone of voice, it's telling you, get it off. If I say it in a pleading tone of voice, I'm saying, please get it off. And if I say it in a humorous tone of voice, I'm saying, laugh at it. You know, so a tone of voice can change the same words and give them different meaning. So my tone of voice becomes part of what I'm saying. My expression, my body language, my dress, or any gestures or movements that I make, all of these things are also ways I am consciously or unconsciously communicating something to you. And for the sake of clarity at the moment, I'm going to focus principally on the verbal aspect of all this. I just don't want you to forget that context in which the verbal takes place. The problems we have with words, and we'll call the other the context of the words, if you will, the meta-communication. Now, when I put my ideas, thoughts, and feelings into words to make them audible to you, you hear them. And you also see the context in which they're being delivered, or feel it kinesthetically one way or the other. And that hearing and seeing, or that kinesthetic sensibility you have of them, all cause a response inside of you of some sort. And you turn around, and that response, which is very complex and will depend very much on your mood at the moment, on what you understand given words to mean, which will come from your history more than from the dictionary, and upon your conscious or unconscious reaction to things like the fact that I have a beard or that I have gray hair or whatever, those things will all influence your response on a very nonverbal level already. And when you take that into account, you have certain ideas, certain thoughts, and certain responses or feelings that are generated at any rate. And you take that internal response and you turn around and you put it into your own words or gestures if you're going to talk back to me. And I then take your communication into myself and we start the circle all over again. I translate your communication into my thoughts, words, and ideas. And we begin the circle again. Now, it ought to be obvious that then that the simple process of my speaking to you is not so simple, that it's extremely complicated, and that there are numerous possibilities at any part of that chain for misunderstanding, for confusion, and not the least of which is your personal prejudice against beards, or your personal experience of intimacy, or your mood at this moment, or your desire to be out in the sunshine instead of listening to me, or whatever. Okay? There's also the problem that nearly every word of the nearly 600,000 in the English language, everybody learned at least one new thing just now, there are at least 600,000 words in the English language, that each of them has more than one meaning, and that the 500 words that form the basic vocabulary for most Americans have a dictionary definition count of about 14,000, which means an average of 28 meanings per word. And you can see how difficult even a simple communication can become when two of us are trying to talk with one another. And when you're preoccupied with some problem of your own, when something I've said has triggered a train of thought in you that takes you away from the here and now, then you're not even hearing what I'm saying. And if I have some distracting mannerism, say I look at the ceiling all the time while talking to you, and in speech class you were told that's the last thing a speaker should do is look at the ceiling, then you're marking me with an F for public speaking and not hearing what I'm saying. I don't wish to do more than give you that rapid overview of the communications problem, other than alert you to it as a background to what we're going to be talking about here, what we're talking about. It is obviously not a problem that dissolves when we're involved in private speaking any more than when we're in public speaking here. In fact, if anything, it's a problem that's greatly aggravated when that communication is one of importance going on between you and I, here and now, in an important relationship we have. I think, in fact, that the degree to which our dialogue is one that is taking place between two of us who are trying to express ourselves on an intimate level, we are running into that much more complexity and that much more difficulty. The further I remove myself from a personal relationship of us two, the further I move away in time and space, in a sense, the more free I can be with my comments. It's so easy to be objective and talk about what happened to me last year or 6 years ago or something like that. And it's much more difficult to talk about what's going on between us right now and how I feel at this moment and how you feel and what I feel about how you feel and so on. Okay? So the more we are in the here and now and just you and I talking, the more intimate we have become. And the more distant I get from that, the less the process of self-disclosure and self-revelation, which we defined as intimacy, is going on. Now, those who heard me speak in the whole You series of the necessity of living in the here and now, that's on the tape called The Time of Our Lives, can see the application at this point of what I spent an entire session on there. If while you are speaking to me, I'm thinking of what I want to do later this afternoon, or the breakfast I had this morning, or the phone call I got an hour or so ago, you see, then I'm not here for you. I'm not really here for you. I'm not present for you. And it's going to be difficult for me to speak to you. It's going to also be difficult for you to generate in me the responses you want, because I'm not here. I'm back there, or I'm out there in the future or someplace, but I'm not here. And I won't be hearing you because I'm not here. Consider for a moment the times of intimacy you have experienced, and haven't they really been encounters in the here and now with another, when the past and the future, so to speak, were set aside and weren't the real preoccupations, but we were truly present for each other in the openness of the moment? Those are the particularly warm, fuzzy, intimate encounters. When I set aside other concerns, when my focus is entirely upon you and what you are telling me, I've opened myself up to receive the gift of yourself. Gabriel Marcel, the French existentialist philosopher and playwright, nice man. I love French philosophers like Marcel because they use as philosophical concepts terms like charm, you know, and presence. And he calls this presence. He says, I am being present for you at that sort of moment, and I'm allowing you to be present for me. And those are very treasured moments. They're the sort of moments the young woman whose letter we read last week found truly life-saving. That sort of moment saved her life. It may be worth our while at this time to look at some of the ways in which we can cut off or negate intimate dialogue with another, ways we have of distancing ourselves, often unconsciously, sometimes even unwillingly, sometimes the lack of awareness of what we're doing there is the only problem. Now, the first of these barriers we place to truly intimate verbal communication flows from just what I've described. When the other party says, you're not paying attention, I can see you're not listening right now. Or are you listening to me? Those are very good clues that we may be paying attention to some other time, some other event, to some inner dialogue going on in us. And we have therefore let this other person know that he or she is wasting the present moment, that he or she isn't there for us in the here and now. Another negation of intimacy is when I am so focused on my own self that I can only look for openings in what you're saying so that I can talk. We've all met people like that. There are friends of mine who would think that sometimes I'm one of them. I once had a young professional woman of multiple talents, very interesting work, seated at my dinner table beside a man who had only that week been complaining to me about the fact that there were not any intelligent, beautiful, and articulate women around. You see, there just weren't. I couldn't believe this because everywhere I go, I meet such women. But here he was complaining, so I invited him to dinner when this particular woman was coming to dinner, and I watched him talk nonstop throughout the entire dinner about his work. He lectured on his pet subjects, and he accepted any comment of hers, and she occasionally got one in with a sledgehammer sort of a blow, you know, and a little aside, an ironic remark. He'd miss all those nuances because he was only using them as launching pads for another comment of his own, another lecture of his own. And she went home. She had her own car, and she chose to leave early. I didn't blame her. After she had gone, I asked him what he thought of her work, which is very interesting work. I asked him what he thought of other aspects of her being that I knew about, and he was absolutely dumbfounded. He had totally missed. She wasn't even there for him. She was an audience, you see. And to the degree that I treat you only as member of audience, you're not here for me. Okay. Now, back at the fort, he's one of these people who used his opportunity for some sort of closer contact with a human being to talk about himself. She could have been anyone at all then. And we now know why he couldn't find any articulate, intelligent, beautiful persons in the city. He's too full of himself to notice them. Now, in therapy with husbands and wives, I often watch the spouse who has supposedly been listening to the other person and now has begun to respond with, now, it's my turn, you see, going to launch in. And I've mentioned this before. It's the most common failing of all is when I say, whoa, which is the second thing you learn in therapy school, how to say whoa and when to say it. And that's what you pay a lot of money for. He says, whoa. And I say, you know, tell her what you heard her say, or tell him what you heard him say. Before you respond, tell him what you heard him say. And they spend the next 3 minutes looking around the room trying to find those words that they missed. They're not there. They're total blank. And why? Because they haven't been there. They've been 5 minutes ahead of the person who's talking, framing their defense and rehearsing it. They're listening to another voice, not the person talking to them. They're listening to their voice giving the speech of response. And they're totally dumbfounded. So should one be surprised that they've come in seeking help to increase their sense of intimacy? They're having communications problems. Well, of course they are. They're talking to themselves instead of one another. That breaks you up, huh? Okay. Well, it's true. Okay. Interrupting you is also a signal of my lack of regard for what you have to say. When I interrupt, I am announcing that what I have to say is more important than what you are saying. And that's a very devastating comment. See? It's also judging, without having heard it, the importance of what you're about to say. Because I've just stopped you from saying it, saying what I've got to say is more important. And that's a true barrier to intimate communication, because that interruption may convey the message, you don't have anything new to tell me. And in a lot of relationships, that's precisely what it's saying. And so aside from being rude, it's a very evident roadblock to your continued self-revelation, because why should I tell you if you feel I have nothing new to tell you, if you're not going to see that I'm growing all the time? An adjunct to this, a corollary, if you will, is when I will even rush to complete your sentence so I can get to my own. You're being too slow at completing your sentence, so I jump in and I finish it for you and go on into what I want to say in regard to this. And once again, I'm not hearing you, so we don't have any intimate possibility for closeness here. I have a friend, a very grand woman who does marvelous work, and she has an enormous heart, enormous energy. But I fear that we're never going to get to know one another really well, because she has one awful habit. And that is that tremendous energy of hers so overflows that whenever I try to talk to me, whenever I, did you hear that? Those of you who know me. know that I can steamroller anybody except this person. Whenever I try to talk with her, she completes every single sentence for me, jumps to the conclusion she thinks I'm going to make, makes a speech about that, you see, and then I have to come back with, no, you're absolutely wrong. This is what I'm trying to say. And I start my new sentence, and she jumps in and completes that one, and we just never, we spend an hour getting one sentence out, you see, and then I'm not sure she heard it. She'd make a great character in a play, but she makes intimate dialogue very, very difficult. That may be one reason she's not married. I don't know. I've often thought what it would be like to be on a date with her, you know, or something. Because she mind reads in that fashion, and then it gets very difficult to talk. There's another way such mind reading may work against intimacy. If I've already made up my mind what your reaction to me will be, how you're going to respond to something I'm going to say, what you're going to tell me, what you're going to say, I may translate for you very abruptly and quite wrongly. For example, say that I want to invite you to dinner, but because of my low self-image or because of whatever reason, I fully expect you to refuse. See? So I ask, and then you say, well, when I get back to my office, I'll look at my calendar. Okay? And I may then respond, never mind, it was only a thought, forget it. See? Because I've just retracted an invitation because I took your statement as the refusal I expected. When in point of fact, your statement meant, I'll take a look at my calendar when I get back in my office. See? This prejudgment of your response, a prejudgment which I will make fit, can very often lead to rather ludicrous scenes, even in the intimate or romantic dialogue sort of thing. Like, let's say one is unsure about the other's love, you know? So I say, do you love me? Of course I love you. You don't sound like it when you say it that way. Well, I mean it. Well, you don't have to get impatient with me. Who's impatient? I'm not impatient with you. I just told you I loved you, didn't I? You're angry with me. I don't know how you can love me when all I do is make you angry and impatient. Sometimes, dear, I wonder myself, but I do love you. Ah, but you do wonder about it. You do doubt it. I knew that you doubted you loved me. You see, and I'm sure some of you have been involved in that kind of dialogue, you know, where you wonder, how did we get here from there? You see, another prejudgment has just been fulfilled. There are other ways to shut down or keep out intimacy of communication between us on the verbal level. One is to be a competitor. I'm feeling very sad. My pet cat, I've had it for 10 years, just died this morning. Now, that's a revelation when somebody says that to you, huh? You've opened a door into what's going on in you in the here and now to somebody if you tell them that. You're sharing something about your feelings at the moment, see? Now, if I'm a competitor, I'll shut that door you just opened. And the way I'll shut it is, I've had 3 cats in the past 6 years. First was hit by a car. Second one died of distemper. Last one, a real beauty, was poisoned by some neighbor kid. God, it was awful to see him die. You see? What I've just done is smother your self-disclosure with all this information about what's going on in my past, usually attempting to surpass your plight of the moment. And, you know, you say, I was feeling lonely yesterday, or I'm feeling lonely today. Loneliness? You don't know what loneliness is. Did I tell you about how I spent 6 months in solitary in Folsom? You know, and I've just knocked aside your disclosure of yourself and where you're at in the here and now, and I've played Can You Top This with it. And it's one sure way to put a barrier to communication. Because in other words, I've just told you I'm not interested in where you're at. I'm interested in showing you that I've had a worse experience or a better one or whatever. And in a competitive society, that's not uncommon. That's not an exaggeration. I think if you'd pay attention, you're going to see people doing that. You're going to hear people doing that in the course of a dialogue that is not even intimate. And in intimate dialogue, it occurs too. It's part of a competitive society thing, and it's another way we stop people from continuing. We discourage them from revealing themselves. Another very common method of shutting off intimate disclosure is by my discounting it. Discounting usually occurs when I feel threatened or disturbed or unable or unwilling to cope with your raw feelings. You don't know what to do about it. You say, I feel very lonely these days. And the discounter would reply, why on earth should you feel that way? Look at all the friends you've got. Why, that's ridiculous that you should feel lonely, you see. And would try to, in other words, discount it, talk you out of it, say, you know. Or, I feel such a failure. Nonsense. There's no reason for you to feel that way. You'll get over that soon enough. You see? In other words, nobody's coming in touch with the feeling statement. The discounter is staying clear of that. I'm really sad, so sad I could cry. Oh, hell, there's no need to cry. Every cloud has a silver lining. Tomorrow's another day. You'll feel great after Friday. You know. And so once again, I've ignored, not come in touch with, been afraid of, in one way or another, shut the door on your self-disclosure by discounting it. Discounting your feelings tells you that you have no right to feel what you feel very often. That's where that nonsense or ridiculous, how can you feel that way? Look at all your friends, you know, count your blessings, etc. Is a way of saying you don't have any right to feel what you're feeling. That you shouldn't feel what you're feeling. Now I'm going to make you feel guilty about feeling what you're feeling. Why, you shouldn't feel that way. And the fact is, of course, that if we're feeling that way, we do feel that way. But all of those messages from the discounters tell you that you've wasted your energy telling the discounter what's truly going on with you. So there's no sense trying to be intimate with a discounter at that point. Now, there's another version of this, usually practiced by the males in our society, and it's one of the most common ways husbands have of driving their wives crazy. This is the objective approach to the feeling state. See, because it's really when we're discussing our feelings, when I'm sharing my feelings, that I'm on an intimate level. We've mentioned this before here. When I tell you about thoughts or ideas, I could have stolen those from anywhere. But when I talk about my feelings, I'm talking about me, where I live. And the objective approach to the feeling state usually goes something like this. An intimate disclosure has been made, and the way the objectifier avoids dealing with the intimate disclosure is to say, well, let's look at the facts. Or objectively, there's nothing for you to be sad about. Give me one good reason for you to feel that way. You see? We're going to take a reasonable, rational approach. People who've gone to Jesuit schools are especially guilty of this sin. And it's one reason they have such difficulty getting to heaven. Obviously, this is another way. Having gone to a Jesuit school, I can say that, you see. Obviously, this is another way of discounting, of getting out of dealing with this other person's feeling state, of avoiding contact with the feeling level. It permits the objectifier to avoid getting into that state himself. It allows me to put a barrier up to feeling what you're feeling. I just tell you, well, let's look at the facts. You know, the facts of the matter are this. And what's at issue is not facts at all, but feelings. One thing most of these responses have in common, whether they're from the discounter or an objectifier or the competitor, is that their responses, the responses of such people, are totally irrelevant to the issue at hand. Totally irrelevant responses. The issue is how the person who has disclosed his or her feelings feels, and the irrelevant response misses coming in touch with that area and shuts the door against further exploration of the feelings, in other words, shuts the door to further intimacy. Another barrier I can raise to intimate personal dialogue is to take the stance of one who is expected to evaluate, judge, criticize, or critique what you have to say. If I tend to be moralistic, a graduate of Jesuit school or something, I may comment, that's right, or how wrong can you get, you see, on something you've just told me. When what you've said about your feelings or yourself is really neither right nor wrong, but simply a statement of what you're feeling at the moment. If I tend to be a critic, my response may flow out as, that's nice, or I don't like your attitude, or that's the worst thing you might say. It's obvious, then, that in order to foster intimacy and to encourage self-disclosure between us, we're going to do well to avoid such negative stances. We could list more, but we don't have time. We do well also to check out whether we are ourselves guilty of being lecturers, interrupters, mind readers, judges, competitors, objective viewers, whatever. And if so, recognizing how we've been raising our own barriers against the intimacy we say we seek. Likewise, of course, things like labeling and sarcasm and name-calling and accusations are quick turn-offs for any intimate exchange. I think that goes, you know, without too much emphasis here. Accusations such as, oh, you only care for yourself, or sarcasm such as, oh, yeah, I can see how much you care, or labeling, well, that's what I call being self-centered, are all offensive and even counterproductive methods of dialogue, and they can surely kill off the desire for any further dialogue at all with us, let alone the delicate enterprise of our trying to share ourselves with one another. Now let's look at what we might do in a positive way to enhance our relationship with those with whom we want a greater degree of intimacy. I don't think there are too many people who don't wish to have their relationship many of their relationships more open to self-revelation, to self-disclosure, more capable of meeting their own and the other person's need for human companionship, support, and understanding. It's not good for any of us to be alone, and it is in the growth of intimacy that we overcome our sense of aloneness. So far, I've been stressing verbal exchanges because that's the troublesome area for so many, but I think it vital to remind ourselves again at this point that the verbal is only one form of self-disclosure, one way of communicating ourselves. All of our nonverbal modes of self-revelation must validate our words, or else what tools we pick up from a session like this simply become manipulative devices and are soon recognized as such. So assuming a sincere friendship, a love relationship, a marriage, a parent-child relationship, at least an acquaintanceship we'd like to deepen or improve in terms of self-revelation and in terms of mutual trust, let's see how we might apply some positive insights to strengthening such. And in the whole You series, I dealt at length with the ways in which we cope with our own feelings and how to deal with them and how we can come to a better self-understanding and self-acceptance of what we're feeling and the expression we can give them. Right now, I want to explore ways we can express those same feelings to another in a fashion that is truly intimate. It is the ineptitude some of us show in seeking to convey our feelings to another which is the source of such tension in our relationships, and in my therapeutic experience, it is here that some relationships hit the shoals of misunderstanding, which brings some to the shipwreck of alienation, breakup, and divorce. Now, there are a number of ways we have to open to us to give expression to what we're feeling at a given moment in our relationship. And perhaps the easiest way to state my feelings is just to state them. I'm feeling sad. I feel rejected. I feel very close to you right now. This sort of labeling of our emotions at the moment is a clear statement. It does require that we be in touch with our feelings and that we properly name them and that we own them as ours. What we must be careful to avoid in this is attributing them to some other person. You are rejecting me instead of I feel rejected. You see, you make me angry instead of I feel angry. Such language blames the other and brings about a defensive reaction and has a distracting effect and a distancing effect on the other. The simple statement of my own feelings has, on the other hand, the advantage of leaving all your options open. For I've only disclosed to you where I am right now, in the here and now, in my feeling state. And your response to that statement will depend entirely upon your respect for my feelings, your own present feelings towards me, and where you are in your present feeling state. Now, there are some feelings which are a bit more complex, more difficult to describe with a simple label. And it's these that we can try to express through a metaphor, or simile, or figure of speech. I feel like I've been hit by a freight train going at high speed. Or I feel like I've just discovered a new world. That's another way of saying where we're at. Sometimes we can state our feelings in terms of what action they're prompting us towards. I feel like I need some fresh air. Or I feel like cuddling you right now. Or I wish I could cry right now. Or I feel like shouting the news to the world, are all statements that imply, you know, I feel like doing some given thing. That tells something about what I'm feeling, and it's a way of describing my feelings to another person. When we describe our own feelings, it helps to clarify them not only for the other person, but for ourselves. It really helps for us to get in touch with them. But basically what we're about here when we're describing them verbally is trying to share them. And until I give expression to what I'm feeling, You're going to have to mind read or guess from some nonverbal communications or from some interpretation of what I'm trying to say about something else where I'm at. And that generally is very treacherous in regard to relationships because there aren't that many good mind readers around. You know, there just aren't. There are only a few Uri Gellers and there are people who doubt him. And so most of us are not good at mind reading. And given our subjective problems in regard to situations that we're involved in, we very often aren't very good at reading the other signs, quote, the body language, etc. I mean, you know, when you're scratching your head, it may be that you have a louse up there and not that you are wondering what's going on. You know, I don't know. But there are people who keep jumping to they've read a book somewhere and they jump to conclusion on that. Now, I mean, you know, I might greet you and find that you're more distant to me than I expected today. So then I go and, whoa, if I have low self-image, I'll say, what did I do wrong? Where did I go wrong? You know, or he doesn't like me, or wow, he's out to get me, or whatever. And it may be that you just got word that your brother was seriously ill and you're worried about it. You see, it have nothing to do with me. And unless I can check that sort of thing out, why, then I've allowed it to interfere with my relationship with you. Some, especially men, find positive feelings difficult to share. The point I'm making is that one of the most regular complaints I have from wives is, oh, I know he loves me, but he never says it. Or when I try to get him to say something sweet, he just backs off saying he wouldn't be there paying the bills if he didn't love me. Now, how romantic is that, I ask you? By not expressing their positive feelings, such persons keep their distance emotionally and rob their relationship of some of the more tender and warm moments of closeness available to them. It is more often men who do this, as I say, and my hunch is that it is precisely the warmth and tenderness that they don't know how to handle. They were told that those things were feminine. But if some have trouble with expressing positive feelings, more of us have difficulty with negative ones. And yet, to share with you my negative feelings, especially when those negative feelings I have are about what is going on in our relationship, that can be very crucial to the life of our relationship. The suppression of negatives doesn't mean that they go away. What happens is that they will simply get stored up, and sooner or later we can have an accumulation of petty irritations, past resentments, unexpressed hurts and angers, which leave little room for positive feelings and cause all kinds of bewildering explosions off here and over there, little ambush attacks that one doesn't know where they're coming from. Unfortunately, romantic lovers insist on translating the negative communications of the other into positives. You know, there's the man with crude manners who is classed by his girlfriend as so masculine, manly, you know, this sort of thing. He's so strong, etc. Or the girl who is sloppy and irresponsible gets called spontaneous and carefree, you see, until you have to live with it. What happens, however, when such lovers marry is that the reality has to be coped with day by day, and there being no previous pattern in the relationship for expressing such honest feelings that may be negative, then the coping can become difficult. The motivation for suppressing negative feelings about the other or immediate resentments is the fear that it's going to hurt the other or that the other will be lost to us. And we'll lose this intimate contact we want. That's the truth, you know, that the truth does sometimes hurt. And yes, sometimes other people can't bear the truth and they're going to run away. But a truth couched in terms of love, of concern for the relationship, and in terms of the good of the beloved is rather like the hurt of the dentist's drill. It's going to preserve the tooth rather than let it rot away and abscess and cause greater pain later and have to be pulled. I'm disappointed in you for not keeping your word, or you promised to meet me for lunch and then didn't show up. I'm really angry about that. Or I'm mad as hell at you for keeping me waiting by the phone for that call you promised that didn't come. Such straightforward statements are as essential to the good health of a caring relationship as are the sweet and positive ones, and they are also intimate statements. Because they're telling what I'm feeling, about what I'm going through, and they're talking about the quality of our relationship. If the relationship cannot stand such honesty, such straightforwardness, then you have to question the quality of the relationship. It's surely not an intimate one, for the obvious reason that we can't here and now be honest and open with one another about what we're feeling. Especially in the context of therapy, I find I often have to educate people in regard to what are not feeling statements. I feel you're not listening is not a feeling statement. It's a judgment of what's going on here. It's my perception of that you're not listening, but it's not a feeling statement. I feel that movie was lousy is not a feeling statement either, but a critical judgment. It had nothing to do with feelings, you see. Some people, having grasped the notion that feeling statements are to be preferred to you, and especially you always, you never, you ought statements, which you're distancing, they will simply slap an I feel in front of a you statement. Such a cosmetic job, which is what it is, doesn't work because the statement remains a you statement. I feel you never talk to me anymore is just as much a you statement as you never talk to me anymore. A feeling statement is, you know, I feel cut off from you. Okay. In all such communications, it's useful to remain as specific as possible and not to generalize. You just knocked over my teacup is a statement of fact. Now look what you've done, clumsy, is not only name-calling, but accusatory and distancing. If the other interrupts you, it's much preferable to say, you just interrupted me, which is a statement of fact and very specific and calling a person's attention to something they've just done, right? The other then has some choices, such as saying, sorry, please go on. But if you say you don't give a damn what I have to say, which is your comment on the specific fact that has just occurred, the whole exchange has now been put onto a different topic, another plane, and one probably doomed to closing us off from each other for at least a while. It's also best to avoid questions that can be put into statements. If I want to go see a movie, it's much more honest and self-disclosing to say, I'd like to go see Manhattan. How about you? Than to say, how would you like to go to a movie? Say, Manhattan. The latter is asking what you'd like to do, not telling you what I'd like to do. And since the how would you doesn't tell you what I'd like to do, you may simply say, no, I'd prefer to go out to dinner. And then I've set myself up for resenting the fact that you kept me from doing what I'd like to do that evening, quote, but I didn't tell you what I'd like to do, so I was the one who kept me from doing it. You didn't have the data because I didn't disclose it to you. A lot of people do that. They always give the power to the other that way. And you may have decided that I was inviting you to the movie because I thought you wanted to go, you see, and since you didn't want to go, why, you know, you were being straight. But if I had told you that I wanted to go, then you've been given the opportunity of going to the movie and pleasing me by going with me, you see, which is another choice entirely. Expressing our feelings is only part of the development of intimacy in relationship. It's necessary for us to keep ourselves open to the responses of the other and to the other's feelings by checking them out regularly. In a caring relationship, I do care how you feel, and I'm regularly confronted with persons who are trying to second-guess their mates or their friends, who are trying to mind-read or otherwise figure out what's going on with the other. I know what he said, but I guess it's because he's been so bothered by what's going on at his office. Or, she says it's up to me, but I know she'll be disappointed if. He's really uptight these days. I think his ex-wife is pressuring him. Some people make all kinds of excuses for the behavior of others or the words of others, interpreting them to a fairly well, and oftentimes end up having collaborated in their own disillusionment, hurt, or distancing. I know of one very loving married couple who bought a very expensive home, and less than a week after they moved in, discovered he had been for the purchase because he thought she wanted it, she had been for it because he thought she wanted it. You know, each of them thought the other wanted this place, and in fact, neither one of them cared very much for it. Since they hadn't talked about the matter, they, like the others just mentioned, had indulged in mind-reading from the visible signs, and the safer course for any of us is to check out our perceptions of what's going on with the other person. You appear to be angry about something this evening. Is that so? You know? I get the impression you're confused by what I just said. Is that right? I have the impression you're worried about the time. Am I keeping you from something? In such checking out statements based upon my perceptions of what's going on, which is really my imagination applied to what's going on here, you see, then if I check it out, I can get a clear statement, you see. I can avoid the leap to some prejudgment. I don't make the leap to a conclusion that may be unwarranted by what's really going on. And at the same time, I avoid that sort of error. I'm also inviting you to be more open in the sharing of your feelings of the moment with you. I invite you to intimacy in the here and now. If I say, gee, you look like you're angry at something, is that so? I just said, hey, it's okay to tell me. You know? In asking such a question, I'm sharing a willingness to hear from you. Such feedback based on my perceptions is crucial, as is verbal feedback in regard to something you've just tried to convey to me in words. To paraphrase what you've just said shows I've been listening and puts me in closer touch with your feeling state. It allows you to correct me if I've misunderstood you, and it makes my response to your statement more meaningful and to the point because it's a response based upon something heard, empathized with to some degree, and verified by you as correct, correctly understood. It might be a good exercise for some of us to give feedback as often as possible to the people closest to us. It's an exercise which would break us of any of the poor communications habits we may have fallen into. It helps us avoid all those negative stances I've outlined at the outset. If I'm listening knowing I'm going to feed it back to you, then I'm listening for understanding, which is what communication is all about. I want to be sure I understood you. Are you saying that my sense of what you're telling me is, do I hear you telling me you feel are very good lead-ins, but they're not the only ones to feedback? But by such active listening, I get in closer touch with your feelings, and I'm in a much better position to respond adequately as your intimate to them. Now, there's no day on which you and I can be said to know one another totally. The development of an intimate relationship is a lifelong task, as we indicated in our initial talk. There is also no doubt at all about the fact that it's a task which is one of the most rewarding of human accomplishments. For true intimacy is the basic labor of love. We're called upon to create. But we will have more to say about that language of love in our final talk. And next session, our third session, we're going to explore sexual intimacy in a talk entitled Having Sex or Making Love, and some of the in-between things people do, too.